Welcome, everybody. Welcome to our May 2021 webinar on a topic that you requested, which is everything about NFTs. What are they? Where are they going? And literally, how do you think about them? I'm going to be introducing my two guests today to our Abundance Digital community and to my social media community. And again, we're going to dive deep. And let me just read the subjects I want to cover today. I want to talk about the history and origin of NFTs, where they really come from. It's been crazy now for the last few months, but they date back quite a bit. And the two gentlemen that I'm speaking with here are, in my mind, the originators of this. Second, you know, what is the big idea of an NFT? Is it the world's largest garage sale, or is there, you know, a there? How is it going to change the world? Because it has the potential to significantly change the world. Where are NFTs going? And then what are their real beneficial uses to humanity? So that's our conversation, and super proud to be bringing to the table two extraordinary individuals. Let me introduce them. But first, let me say hello to Eric and Craig. Eric, Craig, how are you doing, my friends?
Great. Hey, Peter. Thanks for having us on.
Yeah, doing fantastic. Yeah. Great afternoon. Great topic.
Yeah, no, of course. So Eric Pulier, full disclosure, a dear friend, a co-conspirator. I'm on his board and he's on my board for at least one or two of our companies. He's a widely published author and speaker and technologist. He is one of the only people in the United States to have founded six ventures worth over $100 billion. I mean, extraordinary success. And was named one of the 30 e-visionaries by VAR Business. He is currently the founder and CEO of Spatial Web and vAtom Systems. He is focused on, you know, the spatial web with remote everything, everywhere economy, a magnum cum laude graduate from Harvard, no slacker there. So more from Eric, as you see his brilliance. And Eric's the first person I've ever heard speak about NFTs. And it's not been the last 5 months. It's been, you know, like over 5 years ago. Craig Sellars. Welcome, Craig. Craig leads the development of global blockchain innovations as an inventor of the stablecoin, the digital US dollar on the top of the Bitcoin blockchain, as a founder of Tether, the world's most broadly traded cryptocurrency. He is the co-inventor of NFTs and digital objects, and as the chief technologist of Bitcoin's OmniLayer, a protocol which supports the creation, movement, and exchange of digital assets. His current development focus is on the creation of open source decentralized identity protocols and applications, with degrees from computer science from Georgia Institute of Technology and years of experience in private venture. He is truly, you know, one of the most qualified people to discuss this. So, Eric and Craig, welcome, guys.
Thank you. So great.
You know, it's been insane where everybody, their mother and their grandmother, has started talking about trading NFTs in the last, you know, it hasn't been 6 months. It's been like the last 3 months. And whenever you see that, it's like, huh? What? Where'd this come from? And what does it mean? So can we just, like, for the first, let's dive into the history and origin of non-fungible tokens, because both of you were there, in my mind, at the very inception.
Yeah, sure. I'm gonna give a lot of credit in this story to Craig. I'm so proud and honored to be on the virtual stage here with him. He truly is a luminary in this space, many spaces, actually. But, you know, my history with this intersects with his back in the beginning, when the innovation of blockchain was first gaining speed in a lot of sectors. There was a bit of a frenzy among the largest companies in the world, thinking that they would adopt it and how would they do it and would it be disruptive and what would it undermine and change. And there was a lot of confusion around the space. And I was deeply in there, really more in the enterprise space. And every token was really fungible. You know, one Bitcoin looks like the next. No one's ever seen a Bitcoin. It doesn't really react if you do something to it. It is an entry in a ledger. And so I was really looking at this a little bit differently because the complexity was mind-boggling. And I was deeply in it and saw that it was going to take a long time to unfold in some of the more, say, large ways. And so I really just said, well, what if we put all that aside and made a beer? We don't have to take down the world global economy. What if I could make a beer on blockchain and give it to you and I don't have it anymore? What if you could give it to the bartender and get a real one? And what if it would change state and actually get warm if you left it out in the head of the virtual refrigerator? And then, you know, you start to go from there and you're like, oh my gosh, if I could do that, then it could be a ticket. If it could be a ticket, it can be a HIPAA compliant prescription bottle. It can be a land title. So we start to get into my background, which was policy and state changes and IoT. And you suddenly, the light bulb goes off and says, my gosh, this is the evolution of human engagement. And so I went to Craig, and Craig, you might remember this story. And I said, Craig, you may be inventing one of the second most important inventions in the world, which is you actually put Tether out there, which is, I don't know, trading. I can't even begin to describe the volume of what he's created and co-created. But I took it about seconds before Craig's eyes lit up and said, you know what, we got to do this. Craig, maybe
What year is this?
It was right after Tether launched, to early 2015, I believe.
Yeah, so we were actually having, like I said, Tether launched in January of 2015 after we built the prototype. We were having lunch with Eric, with Reeve Collins, the CEO then of Tether. And what was interesting was that as Eric was describing this idea of the beer, his conception was basically, I want to be able to take, you know, an image of a beer on my phone and swipe it up to the bartender and actually, you know, redeem this digital object. We were talking about the ability to redeem digital dollars, but they were all fungible. And he's obviously talking about bottles of water. Could you tokenize other things that are physical? And what's funny is that for me, the idea of a digital object or having like an image representing the thing wasn't the innovation. It obviously was, because that's what's happening right now with all of the NFT craze. What was amazing to me is when Eric said, well, what if you don't redeem it in a couple of days? Can the beer get warm? And I looked at Reeve and I said, Reeve, I quit.
Because
if we have the ability to change the state of a token and make it unique, that is the most important invention we've ever seen. Because now that means everything that's in the real world that is finite and is non-fungible now can be represented on a decentralized peer-to-peer permissionless blockchain. And that's the conception right there.
I just, you know, this NFTs were not invented 6 months ago or 6 weeks ago. It was 6 years ago by these two individuals. And so Eric Pulier and Craig Sellars, I mean, it was amazing. I remember learning about it from you, Eric. And I was like, same thing. It's like, boom. It's like, this is huge. The permeable membrane between the virtual world and the real world and going back and forth elegantly, simply.
Yeah, it really just dissolved those boundaries. And the project that I was working on at the time, to give credit where credit is due, back to yourself, Peter, you may not know this, but I had an idol at the time and still do, running a company called Deca. And
Dean Kamen.
Yes. So Dean Kamen is probably one of the greatest inventors who's ever lived, not just who's living now. And he put up a challenge to me, which is to distribute clean drinking water into nations that didn't have a monetary system and didn't have identity capabilities. And how would I create a microtransaction system? And how would I distribute that water? And so that was one of the first things that I was talking about in that lunch with Craig, was how do we solve that? And the real problem that I was solving is actually still the main problem that needs to be solved. And that's identity. Because in order to own something, we're talking about owning digital goods. Like, you're not in a game anymore. You're getting rid of the game and you're gamifying the world. You're owning this digital object the same way as if it was physical. But in order to own something, you have to be somebody. And that's what we really need as an underpinning to this entire, say, movement or revolution, is a decentralized identity system. That's where I wanted to start. But the world wasn't ready. That's what I initially funded. Craig did a lot of work on that with and for us. And now, thank God, Craig has picked up the mantle and is focused on that now, because without that, we're just another game.
Yeah, we've actually released the code base at keychain.org and some developer documentation to allow anyone in the world to create their own sort of self-sovereign digital identity. And we're building a company on top of that to sort of be the on-ramps. And there's a white paper coming out here very shortly as well. We took a lot of the ideas that were sort of brainstormed between Eric and myself about what are the fundamental attributes of a digital identity or a general identity. And we broke it down into three very simple components. And it's the declaration of yourself, The attestations are claims that you make about yourself or others, and the ability to delegate authority to others. If you can build a system based on those three principles, you basically have created your own NFT. You are an NFT at that point. You are a non-fungible token.
Now there's the distribution
item that takes different attributes and transforms and changes over time. And that becomes sort of the fundamental underlying technology and premise for ownership of digital goods, because it's tied to your wallet. You are your wallet.
Yes. Yeah. It's really fascinating. And Peter, where it goes from here is really an evolution. It's going to cause a revolution in just about every industry, but it's an evolution of what we have today. And what I mean by that is, if you think about the evolution of online engagement, everyone will have their own opinion, but you might say it starts almost with early email, right? Internet, connecting people to one another, and then message boards, and then maybe some silos like Prodigy and AOL and things like that. And then finally opening up to the original metaverse, which was the World Wide Web, where Tim Berners-Lee actually allowed us to put a hypertext layer on the internet. And suddenly this interface moment, as you call it, attached to this technology. And everyone can build something and make money from it and distribute it and express themselves. And that became the next grand step for human engagement. And then you move from that, those static pages, to dynamic pages, to semantically understood pages and e-commerce and all the different pieces that made it more and more engaging and useful. But now we go to the next step, and it's a major step as important as the advent of the World Wide Web itself, which is the addition of three things. One is identity, two is ownership, and three is a social canvas that extends this surfing, this surface layer where we interact to augmented and virtual reality. So if you take those three things, identity, ownership, and an extension, a social extension of how we actually interact with this digital plane into augmented and virtual reality in a persistent manner, you now will have the emergence of what you might call a metaverse. I just call it the future of human engagement. It'll apply to every sector.
I love it. I love it, pal. And can we just, most people watching this have learned about NFTs from the insanity of the last few months. And it's, can you just speak to what has been going on recently, and then where, you know, not only where it's going, but what the little extension of the big idea, where could it be going? Where do you see it going next?
Greg, do you want to jump on that? I have a couple of ideas I'll take.
Well, as Eric mentioned, talking about the social canvas, what we've seen as like the primary adopter, the primary adopters of NFTs in the past few months have been artists. About 6 to 9 months after we created Vatomic Systems to sort of distribute this concept of virtual atoms or digital objects, we weren't calling them NFTs at the time. There was a project called Spells of Genesis, which was released, and it was actually playing cards. And very shortly after, CryptoKitties, which, you know, crashed the Ethereum blockchain because it was these little, you know, digital objects you could exchange, and it clogged the whole system. But what we've seen is now that it's opened up as this new canvas to artists, that means, painters, sculptors, musicians, et cetera, have a means of representing their art in a digital format. And so what we've seen are these auction sites, the OpenSeas, these decentralized trading platforms that allow these artists to create and represent their works. And, you know, they're scarce. The beauty of the Bitcoin blockchain, its primary innovation was the introduction of digital scarcity. But that was in a fungible sense. Now that we have non-fungible senses, that means that you can actually take any physical object in the real world, be it a piece of art, or a sculpture, or an antique, or, you know, a wrench, and you can put it onto a blockchain. You can put it into a digital ledger. The amazing part of Eric's original conception wasn't just that you could represent art or an image. If you think about the World Wide Web, Tim Berners-Lee, he released a text-based hyperlink system, and it was all text for the first several years. And then one day, somebody put an image on one of their websites. Actually, at the W3C, they put an image of, I think it was women dancing. Okay, then you had multimedia, then you had movies, then you had JavaScript applications. And we're gonna see the exact same evolution here. The idea behind vAtoms wasn't that they were just a piece of art that you would actually have like a thumbnail in your wallet. It was that thumbnail was the portal into an application, something that's actually interactive and experiential. So it's not just, you know, an image of the beer in your wallet. That beer gets warm. And if you also have a digital refrigerator in your wallet, you could put that beer in there and it could now get cool again.
That's right.
We haven't seen anything along those lines yet, except for the original vAtom conception. And that is where the NFTs are going. It's every app on your phone will be an NFT.
And Craig, thanks for that softball, because while you say we haven't seen anything like it, but we are seeing it now. People, what's so great about this movement is that it is bringing the creatives into this space, not just geeks like us. And the creatives and the geeks, and we mix together and we're creating alchemy. And what's coming out of it is nothing short of amazing, because they don't care what it can do. They care what they want to do. Can it do this? Can it do that? Can it do anything? Yes, it can. And what an artist wants is to express their view, to turn their imagination into something tangible that can be experienced by others. But the big innovation here is that you're not just creating something scarce, you're creating something network aware. When you created something scarce that's network aware, it can change state based on the weather, based on sports scores, based on interactions, but also it becomes a living, breathing conduit of communication between creator and owner. This is the key. This is where fandom actually goes to the next level. This is where you cut out the middleman and create an entirely different way to engage audiences and to create, I would say, long-term relationships. Vatoms, what we might call Vatom NFTs now, so people can equate it to the common nomenclature. Vatom NFTs create a communication pathway. That's their power. They create an ability to create relationships that change over time and are value-based. And this is what we're seeing right now in the market. We have over 30 million Vatoms out there in the world now. The most commonly minted type of NFT in the world by the Fortune 500 are Vatoms, because we spent the time to build out, literally 5 years, to build out a massively scalable infrastructure that actually, you can think of it as an IoT-like infrastructure, where these objects can interact with one another, with the environment, with people, and they can take any shape that the artist now wants to, or concept that the artist wants to imbue them with. The next step in this evolution is, as I say, is the manifestation, not just into a canvas, but a social canvas, connecting people together. Our mission is to bring humanity together online.
Yeah,
to extend the world into a massively scalable social world.
So, I mean, everybody watching, I mean, I'm seeing here is the birth of a multi-trillion dollar economic ecosystem that is just at the very beginning. Forget about the CryptoKitties and forget about, you know, some of the crazy prices being paid for video clips or artwork. But I mean, real, true, you know, as humanity moves from the actual world into the virtual world and back and forth. So please put your questions into the chat so that we're going to be going to everybody's, you know, questions or tweet them at me at Peter Diamandis. In fact, Greg, if we can put both Craig and Eric's Twitter handle up, it's for Craig, it's at OmniCraig, at OmniCraig. And for Eric, it's at Pulier, Pulier underscore Eric. I just, it's rare to see where something actually originated and to see where it's coming. Talk 1 second about where the trillion-dollar economy for this, because I believe it and I've heard you speak about it. I just would love for you to share it, Eric and Craig. Where do you see it going?
Sure. Let me jump in and actually add one thing to what Eric previously mentioned about the social canvas again.
Please.
Is that, again, what we've seen thus far are digital works of art or physical things in the real world being digitized and put onto blockchains. The inverse of that is where this trillion-dollar market comes from. And that is taking those digital objects and actually pulling them into the real world, going past VR and going into AR. Think about the Pokemon Go characters on your phone, right? Being able to actually have, again, that viewport into the real world, where the digital objects that are created, these NFTs or Vatom NFTs, now can actually have GPS coordinates. They can actually live in the real world. And of course, when you've got finite things in the real world that you're putting into the digital world, you're actually limited by the number of finite things in the world. In the digital realm, you've got an infinite series of possibilities that you can now pull into the real world. That's where the trillion and quadrillion dollar markets come from in the future.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think this is, I talk about converging exponential technologies and skating to where the puck is going to be. Mm-hmm. And for anybody listening, you know, I remember being on stage for my Abundance 360 community back in 2014 and giving out Bitcoin to everybody in the room and them, you know, on slips of paper. and everybody, you know, like losing it, throwing it away, forgetting about it, not knowing about it. And then it realized was, you know, it's a $50,000 ticket I'm giving you. But this, what you're hearing from Eric and Craig, and I want to, you know, we're going to go to the audience questions in a few moments, but I really want everybody to hear that this is a game. This is a state change. This is a state change for humanity and for human economic systems and for human ownership systems and for human interaction. Fundamental. And it's, you know, time frame for this to really sort of, I mean, we talk about going from when you digitize something, the early days are deceptive and it's disruptive and it dematerializes, demonetizes and democratizes products and services, right? That was my second book, Bold. We're in the deceptive phase, about to become disruptive right now. What's the time frame that you think for this? And paint the picture a little bit more so people really get this and are as frenzied about this as we are.
Yeah, I'll paint a little bit of a time frame from my view. Look, a lot of people are just getting introduced to the concept of NFTs. They see it in a speculative frenzy. There's a lot of gambling going on. As with all things that have a speculative frenzy, there'll be inevitable downfalls and fraud will be discovered and people will see wash trades and they'll understand that a lot of blockchains that people claim are blockchains are really centralized. They might as be MySQL databases on Amazon. So as this stuff starts to shake out, there'll be the same thing that happened with the .com world where everyone says, oh, pets.com didn't work. Therefore, you know, and it, you know, the internet's not going to work. Well, we'll have those moments. But this is here to stay because it's not just a speculative frenzy. That's 10% of the value. 90% is an engagement. And when we look at the time that it's going to take to adopt these things, I really think it's now. It may seem new to a lot of people, but those of us in this, like, you know, 6 years, see that we're already standing on the shoulders of giants. We have people who have been working on this, Gunther Thiel and Lucas Fleury and Alistair and Farquharson and Ashish Vaid. These folks have been working tirelessly for years to build the underpinnings that we can now build on. And I'm forever indebted to Craig for now putting the last pieces in place, like with this identity system. So what we're going to see, not in years ahead, but in months ahead, is the introduction of certain elements that are going to open people's eyes up to how it affects sectors, education, healthcare, government. So for instance, when you go to a pharmacist, you will be getting NFTs that actually are secure, that you know there's one of one, that represent a digital twin of your prescription, that have a HIPAA compliant secure chat back to the doctor and know the contraindications. We'll be seeing things like this. In education, we'll be seeing how place and time will shift as you bring together kind of metaverse environments to give gifts and micro rewards for small acts and behaviors that change how we remember things, and attention span is actually gamified. So education is going to change. Obviously, shopping is going to change. The whole idea of marketing, the post-advertising world, is going to be about aligning values with value. Like, to connect to somebody whose time is valuable to them, you better be in sync with them. And gifting and value is much more important than the types of advertising messages we've seen in the past. So that entire field is going to shift towards this model. So when you say, like, what's coming, I can take you out also 5 years, but to take you out 5 months, we're going to see dramatic change.
Wow. I mean, the speed at which all of these things are accelerating, right? It's de minimis, the costs are de minimis, and therefore the number of experiments and the product market fits and the implications. And it's the impact, probably the biggest impact is going to be on the rising billion, the people out there who are now just getting connected.
I'd like to talk about the rising billion if we could, yeah, because it, you know, that is where we started. When Craig and I sat down, I was talking to him about my hopes for making non-fungible state changeable objects, et cetera. But we really started with this project, which meant to be, how do we distribute value to people who are unbanked? And how do we create a micro economy with microtransactions and entrepreneurial incentive structures? So this is really what's happening also at the merger of what you might call NFTs with what you might call DeFi, decentralized finance. This is nothing to be trifled with. People who are looking, a lot of people look at these emerging trends as get rich quick schemes. Oh, wow, there's a lot of people making money in that. How do I get some of that? That's fine. That's fine. But you also can lose a lot too by playing in that game. If you just look ahead at the implications here, it's staggering. There's trillions of dollars to be made, but there's also billions of people whose lives we can improve. I started in policy. Imagine policy-based NFTs where we can know without any shadow of a doubt we're distributing school books or rides to, you know, rides on a bus that could be exchanged for electricity credits, you know, and that can be visually understood by people and traded with rules and really act as redeemables, but moving value at the speed of light in secure manner. It's staggering what this could mean. I mean, Craig, nobody is more important to this right now than you in bringing this project to light, because if your project comes to fruition, which I hope is our project, our collective minds need to be put on this, then the unbanked will be banked by definition, right? We'll be able to tell their stories and bring their stories to light and distribute the value where it needs to be the most.
I love your heart, Eric. I love who you are as a human being. And Craig, thank you for your work you're doing.
I will echo that as well. Eric, besides a beautiful heart and a beautiful mind, is a pleasure to work with. One of his points about the unbanked becoming suddenly banked is a digital identity really is simply a unique snippet, right? It's something that is unique, and everyone is unique and has a unique attribute about themselves, and you can represent them digitally. As I mentioned, the three components, having declaration, attestation, and delegation, Eric talks about decentralized finance. Well, obviously we have the ability now to, in a permissionless, peer-to-peer, uncensorable manner, exchange value. But once we actually have that delegation component in there, I mean, we live in the US here in a representative republic. We delegate authority to our Congress. Once you actually have digital delegation, we go beyond decentralized finance. We go into decentralized governance.
I love that. I want, you know, people, it's like on women's rights, I want to delegate the vote, my vote, to a woman who knows about that. On space, maybe they'll delegate their vote on NASA's budget to me, because I know about that, right? Mm-hmm. That it becomes a true democracy, but a true representative democracy, where you get to decide. Because right now, the entire governance system is a sham. People don't know what they're voting on. They are, and things are lumped together in levels of detail that make them ridiculous votes. So,
well, Peter, yeah. I say we should be actually turning Congress into a big GitHub repository.
So yes, the technical folks down out there,
you want a code repository. You want to have the citizens to be able to make pull requests and say, here's my conception. And those things could be sponsored by representatives through that delegation process. All of a sudden, we have a participatory democracy as opposed to a delegated one. The possibilities of the power distribution and equality that we actually have opportunities now with this technology are mind-blowing and absolutely staggering.
Yeah. And Peter, don't mistake our excitement for the future and how it might create a better world for lack of practicality for what might happen now. We are actually building things that can be adopted now by the world's largest companies, as I mentioned. The primary use cases of NFTs that I know of in the Fortune 500, not all of them, but maybe 90% that I know of, are building with VATOMs and are building with these concepts that we're discussing here today. So this is practical feet on your ground, on the ground stuff. It's just a matter of when you look ahead, it's nothing like what it is today.
Yeah. You're watching a flower blossom.
Yeah. So guys, again, I'm going to go to your questions right now. Nia will ask them. But I just, every time I sit down and talk to you, Eric, and Craig, it's been a while since we've connected, but super happy to be back in touch and thank you for the work that you're doing. It's crystal. This is the future. And it's not one of those futures a decade away. It's happening at lightning speed, right? And we're going to intercept GPT-3 and GPT-4. We're going to intercept Apple's, you know, AR and VR capabilities. We're going to intercept, you know, Starlink and distributed 5G around the world. And this is going to become, we're going to be living in multiple worlds, virtual worlds, and we're going to be taking our things between them, and it's going to be via VATOMs and NFTs, which
Peter,
are
imagine same. What happens when we actually apply GPT-3, GPT-4, and artificial intelligence to non-fungible tokens. Now, all of a sudden, you'll actually have autonomous digital objects.
Yes. And in fact, we've done that. One thing I do want to mention, and we can show those interested, is that we've applied AI to an NFT in what I think is the most sophisticated use of that technology today to make a dog. I call them distributed autonomous life forms, DALFs. The first version of this was for the Intel Corporation, where they made very basic butterflies and we released them into New York City, and people were able to chase them around in augmented reality and get gifts, and they donated to a charity if you caught it, and they were able to hold things. And that was the inception of this. But their brains were really quite primitive, no offense to the butterflies, but they only knew how to go in circles. But now we're at the point where this dog actually has behaviors and it gets thirsty, and this NFT on Ethereum will go and get a drink, and he'll notice if you're nearby and he'll come over to you. Now, here's what will blow your mind. That's really super cool that we can get into.
As if you haven't already.
but think about this. But the reason why we say this extended social canvas matters as we extended AR and VR is not because we're saying, oh, we got a better game than the next guy. Everyone can make games with AR and VR, and they're awesome. Go play them. That's not this. This is an extension of reality. What makes the brain understand that it's reality is persistence, right? When you leave something there, it's there. If you pick it up, it's gone for everybody. That kind of consensus around what reality is what makes something perceived to be real. And so these worlds, that's what we call them, distributed autonomous life forms, because this dog can lead through a wormhole in the metaverse, in a game, if you will, not in a game, but in the VR version of the web. And it can leave and walk out into Central Park and walk around the park. And you can look at it right now with your phone, eventually with your glasses, and it'll be there in one place at one time. If you pick it up, it won't be there anymore. If it walks back through the wormhole, it'll come right back into the world, and the people there with their digital avatars will see it. So that persistence and that connection between worlds will make this world an extension of to that world, as opposed to a silo.
Awesome. Awesome. All right. Listen, we got 1,000 questions from the community and the Twitterverse. Let's jump in. Nia.
First question from Pam. What app, software, or hardware do I need to get into this artist's network market?
You need a phone and an internet connection.
So someone who is sort of just at the beginning, how do they think about it beyond a phone and internet connection?
Well, what you need to, well, let's say you have a use case. Let's take the simplest use case.
Well, and I think they're talking about just, you know, sort of they're an artist wanting to put out NFT.
Yeah.
Their work.
Let's say the simplest use case is that you're sitting at dinner, you scribbled on the napkin, and you're like, wow, that's pretty good. I wonder if someone can buy that. So you take a picture of it and you can mint it. You can mint it a number of ways. You can mint it with us, you know, you can make a vAtom and you can put it up in a marketplace, or you can go to Nifty Gateway or Rarible or OpenSea. Just about any of these organizations that if you Google NFT, will now have simple NFT makers, and they'll encourage you to put it in there. Now, the real question is, why would you want to do that? And what's the benefit? One thing I can tell you is because of the glut in the market and because of everybody's ease of use and the democratization of this technology, you will have to stand out. That goes down to anything. It's like, if you make a song, how are you going to become number one on the Billboard charts? Well, first we'll have people have to know about you, then they have to listen to it, then they have to like it. So marketing and getting into the slipstream of the community where people will know about you and be able to judge it fairly is going to be important. After that, which I think is happening now, the glut will be so severe that you're going to want to start to get creative and interesting about what is cool about this thing. Does it change? Does it wear an umbrella when it rains? What does it combine with? What does it mean to me? What story does it tell? A very wise man named Gordon Bowen once told me that objects plus story equals treasure. That's the treasure. That's where you make your money. That's what will be lasting. What's the story and narrative around it? So we can tell you how to make an NFT in 10 seconds. The story comes from you.
Beautiful. Next question.
Question from Lena. I'm looking at ways to introduce NFTs for an online business I own, which is retailing gold and silver collectible physical coins. But how do I not confuse our customers, or myself, as I'm learning, as they may think the NFT, because it's a coin design, could be an altcoin and not an NFT?
Great question. Have it that?
Yeah, well, it depends on if you're creating a digital representation of something that doesn't actually have redeemable value to it, or if you're intending to create a digital token that actually can be, in fact, traded for an actual gold coin. In which case, there actually could be some serious regulatory concerns there, because if you've got a commodity that is redeemable for a digital object, you're actually looking at the CFTC. You're looking at actual securities regulation at that point, because you've in fact created a security. And there are exchanges like OpenSea that may actually not be able to list your NFT if in fact it is considered or could be considered a security. So you should walk very carefully in those sense. Now, if you want to just create a token that looks like a gold coin that actually has your branding on it, or actually has your gold designs, that's a whole other thing entirely. The altcoins that exist out there today, they are all fungible. And there aren't really wallets out there that represent them as actual coins. So you getting out there and putting them out there, I don't think you're going to have too much issue with confusion between your coin and an altcoin in that sense. I think that there's a fundamental difference there. And the interface itself will sort of describe that difference and not confuse the user. But be careful about not issuing a security. That's a whole other can of worms.
Yeah, and also important to make sure, as Craig says, that your interface does describe what it is. Like if you click on the coin, it should be able to flip over and tell you, this is a bearer bond for a real coin. And maybe it's a bearer bond for an exact amount of gold, which would be like Tether or whatever, or is it a bearer bond for that exact coin? And in other words, it's actually a digital twin. So you have to just be clear with the metadata around the object of what it is and what it's meant to be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Question from Jed. If you have 50,000 or 5 million and you have to invest it all in 3 coins, tokens, et cetera, for a 2-year lockup, what would you pick?
Oh boy.
It's called investment advice, and I'm not sure I want to allow my friend by legal.
Here's what I would do. I would do whatever Craig would do.
I'll actually paraphrase Brock Pierce and say you should take that money and invest in yourself, which is the education for the platforms that inspire you, the teams that impress you, and go with that gut instinct as opposed to picking and choosing particular coins. Invest in yourself.
I love that. Yeah. Good Brock. Go on, Brock.
It's great advice.
Yeah.
Great advice. Thank you. Next question from Lewis. Could an NFT be assigned to a civil address representing a property or a unit that is part of the civil address, such as a high-rise building?
Yes, of course. The notion of the complexity of title and who owns what and the bureaucracy around it and the paperwork and the fraudulence that could be involved are dramatically improved with NFTs. I mean, it's one of the great use cases ultimately is to prove provenance of something that has real information related to it. And what's nice about an NFT is it also can double as an IoT, device where it can tell you about the property and tell you what's happening over there and give you chain of title and give you real assurity of who owns it. Now, the problem with that concept is it's highly conceptual. What actually gives ownership is not possession of an NFT that someone says, this represents ownership. That has no legal standing. So you still need the title. But the problem is the government and the governance has not caught up to the technology yet.
I remember, Eric,
are NFTs well-suited for that? NFTs are perfectly suited for that. You can't actually represent real estate with a fungible token because real estate itself is not fungible. We've been talking about tokenized real estate for 5 or 6 years. And the reason why it hasn't caught on is because we didn't actually have the technology to represent unique real estate. Now we do. And so when you see real estate tokenized, they will be NFTs.
Yeah,
I was going to say, I remember a few years back when a Stradivarius violin was tokenized, right? Mm-hmm. And you could own a piece of that. And I'm wondering why, tokenized real estate where I can own a piece of a building on Central Park in Manhattan, maybe just a small piece of it. But if I think real estate is unique, real estate is going to be where the wealthiest people in the world are putting their capital, which they are, because it's a scarce resource. Mm-hmm.
Digital objects, digital assets are subdivisible, right? So you'd have an NFT for the high rise. You'd then have NFTs for the units. you then have fractionalized tokens of those units themselves. So you could own 1% of one unit in one building.
And maybe it gives you a right to live there for a day, one day out of a decade.
Well, well certainly that's
the income stream, a portion of the income stream. Yeah.
So why hasn't that? So is that happening now? Or are people working on this?
Yeah,
why hasn't it?
Yeah. They've been working on it for many years, and there's a number of hurdles, but there is also happening. Mm-hmm. As Craig said, these are infinitely divisible, and because of the notion of state change, your token isn't just a mark in a ledger. Your token can actually pop out a free night at the condo and give you dinner for having held it and not sold it for 3 months. By the way, that's exactly how stock certificates gonna work. It used to be you'd give your kid a stock certificate for his, bar mitzvah or something, and he'd hold it, and then it'd be boring. No one wants to own U.S. Steel unless they think it's gonna go wildly up. But if you own the token for U.S. Steel and it said, thank you for holding it 3 months, and it exploded with some gift for you and your wife to go do something, you develop a relationship. Network aware, state changeable tokens will apply to everything. What won't apply to everything is the law, which says, you know what? If you're moving this around at the speed of light and you're not paying your taxes, you're not reporting it correctly, and we consider it a security, no. So do it carefully, do it properly, and be compliant. And the compliance also has to be done in conjunction with those who are making the rules, because they're learning as they're, as they're writing them.
So everything in your world can become network enabled, dynamic, vibrant, interactive, to the point where you don't see it as a thing. You develop a relationship with it and you hope for its evolution.
Yeah, of course. If you don't have a relationship with something, then there's no difference between one thing and the other. That's the entire idea of a brand is that indefinable relationship that you have to pay more for something that may be exactly the same as something cheaper, right? If you don't have a relationship with that, Amazon will kill you. Amazon will reproduce every single thing on the face of the earth and sell it cheaper. There is no one safe and nothing safe unless you develop a relationship.
I hope everyone is hearing this brilliance from you, Eric. It's just every time you speak, it's like, I want to go in and take detailed notes and start another company.
Let's do it.
Nia.
Next question from James. Aside from art, what industries do you see adopting NFTs? Why? How do you see it playing out?
Wow. I mean, every industry. Sort of list of the ones that won't adopt NFTs, because the way I see it is an evolution, as I say, of online engagement. A lot of people are saying, look, what can I do with this token? But when you combine the three elements of next generation engagement, identity, ownership, and a social canvas that extends into AR and VR, then you readily see that you can't unsee it. You can't imagine a classroom that will be effective knowing that this is dramatically more important to increase retention and attention spans and give people a better education. You can't do healthcare without a deeper relationship and a way to exchange objects between people and using the identity system that Craig is building to give selective access to certain attributes of your healthcare records. So each of the things that you now re-examine in light of this next phase of online engagement, you have to recognize that it's going to be impactful. I used to go around evangelizing that everyone should get a website and that the internet's going to matter. And some people agreed, but many people said, I already have a brochure. I already have a TV commercial. I already, do what I do. And I know why Toyota has a website. Why would I need one also? But once everyone started to adopt it and understand it, nobody didn't want a better website, a better way to engage, a more effective way to create a relationship with their constituents, whether they're employees, other businesses, consumers. This is just, as I say, an evolution of that need of that technology, adding a few elements that makes it dramatically better, and then it'll apply to everything the same way the web did.
Yeah.
Who would be the right team to convince local governments to accept NFTs and titles? How would you start this business?
Government.
Yeah, that's actually a fantastic question. You know, we have in the crypto space, we have lobbying organizations like Coin Center or the Chamber of Digital Commerce. Folks who actually do have broad resources in the enterprise space, in the blockchain development space, et cetera, that actually do have that sort of brain trust, sort of the think tanks that have been riding the crest of the wave so they can sort of see what's coming ahead. The regulators today, they're not riding the crest of the wave. They just see a wall of water in front of them. And so if you want to engage governments and regulators in this, you've got to find the folks who have been riding the crest of the wave. Find the lobbying organizations that are already built and designed with these networks of these cryptocurrency or blockchain brain trusts and begin interacting with local governments. Caitlin Long is in Wyoming and has been doing a fantastic job getting Wyoming to be a blockchain sponsoring state where you can actually form a DAO, a decentralized autonomous organization, as a company, as an LLC. That's now legal and permitted and encouraged in states like Wyoming. It's a matter of having those dialogues with your local representatives. Start at the county level, the city level, and say, hey, here's a way of representing title in a sort of an auditable mechanism on a blockchain, and say these records can't be changed. You actually, as a state or as a county or as a city, have the ability to co-attest to these ownership pieces and keep these records sacrosanct. And they can sort of act as custodians of that information. Then you've actually got a decentralized database that actually has the city as one of the approved attesters to your title. Now you, in combination with that regulator, actually have the issuance of that real estate, that ownership. Educating them to those possibilities and creating test beds and pilot programs with them, even at the smallest level, let them dip their toes in and see how this benefits them in terms of efficiency and accuracy. All those things are available to them.
Yeah. And they move a lot slower than the tech. So you have to be patient with folks and do what can be done within the constraints that exist today, but also push to educate and reform.
Question from Nikki. For an emerging DAO that creates communities that transform humanity, what are the best steps to apply NFTs to the mix?
I'll say a few words and turn it over to Craig. I mean, it's almost native to that concept is NFTs. If you're talking about a DAO that is self-governed by the owners of the community, those who participate and live in it and do the work, then you're also talking about incentive structures and different ways to reward those who do pro-social, pro-community activities and dissuade the reverse. NFTs, you think of in this context as policy-based, changeable objects that are interactive, but also still retain value. So you might have something in your wallet as a community member that affects reward systems based on a reputational score. It's very important when you talk about reputation to be really careful, because this is an age-old attempt to say, well, let's incent good behavior and dissuade bad behavior. But if you look at China, or if you watch Black Mirror or look at any science fiction, you'll know that this is filled with potholes because people game the system. And you start to get behaviors. Well, if you reward certain behaviors, then that's the behaviors you get. And that's not really, that's too blunt an instrument. I like to think of the Google opaque algorithm where people are constantly starting SEO companies to try to figure out how to rise in Google ranks, but no one quite understands the Google algorithm and they change it constantly. Similarly, in a DAO-like structure, you have to have general principles that everyone votes on and agrees on. And then you have to have reputation that actually rises and falls generally within that concept of an architecture. But if you get too close with giving reward for action, then everybody just goes after the reward. So I think NFTs are fundamental to that, but even more important are the model that you're organizing the community with and how you run reputation so that when the NFTs are distributed, they're distributed in a way that makes the community stronger.
So the idea of having actual identity and reputation combined is such a leveling force on the planet in terms of uplifting those who are repressed, right? I mean, the saddest thing is is a young genius someplace that happened to be born into the wrong religion or the wrong geography. But, you know, if there's a way of that person's identity and their brilliance, whatever, you know, their reputation, whatever field, mm-hmm. is an extraordinary gift to humanity.
It really is. And that's where, again, I want to go back to the idea of story. Story doesn't just apply to objects. As Craig, I think, brilliantly said, when you have the identity system rolled out, you are the object, you are the NFT, and story applies to you. And as your story starts to rise within the community, so will the rewards associated with your actions that benefit the community. So I think that this is really the beginning. DAO is the beginning of a better world. I'm a huge believer in it. But we're really, really at the beginning. Anyone who comes forward and tells you they're an expert and here's how you do it is you go the other way. But anyone who wants to debate it and talk and mold it together to the next phase, I'm in.
Beautiful. Nia.
Question from Amanda. In a sense, NFTs are manufactured scarcity, similar to diamonds in a way, as our world becomes more reliant on the digital. Do you see NFTs being used to restrict access to parts of the digital environment if they can't afford it? What are the implications of this?
You know, it's when we were conceiving of the original decentralized identity concept, we realized that we had to deploy something that would work both for the Federal Reserve, but all the way back to a refugee showing up at a refugee camp with no pennies in their pocket whatsoever. You can't actually charge someone to record their identity if they don't have any resources to do so. So you actually have to take that into account. There is going to be a full spectrum of completely free digital objects that allow you to register yourself for your attributes, et cetera. But there will also be multi-million dollar pieces of art as NFTs. That full spectrum is going to be available. And so the entry point, as long as it starts as free and then goes up in terms of your resource availability, you have in fact covered the entire world population.
I agree with that. I'll also say that another level, like how people are using these things, of course they'll be used to restrict access, because part of the early use cases of these things will be tickets. By definition, a ticket both gives you access and it restricts access, right? Because you can't get in. A key to a back room. NFTs will absolutely be used by that, and they'll trade based on people wanting to exercise their utility to enter, say, a back room of the metaverse. If you build something in Spatial Web, by the way, if you go into spatialweb.net and you make your own metaverse, which is a native NFT, you know, metaverse, and you were to build a back room and charge $19.95 a month for it, well, you want people to only go back there who have the NFT key, right? So you are restricting people by definition from access with it. At the same time, as Craig says, if you get more philosophical on where we're going, not just the business models of today, then you must accommodate the unbanked and those who don't have access to capital today, because the whole idea is to give them a fighting chance to be part of the global economy, which today they don't have.
Yeah, now once you have a digital identity, we came from, again, that philosophical standpoint that everyone generates value. That's just an inherent attribute of a human being is you generate value, and everyone generates value in a different way. What you have with the digital identity now and through the NFTs is the ability to retain that value and exchange that value with others. So that's it's almost the holding pot for the value that you create now can have digital representation and can be exchanged anywhere in the world by just snapping your fingers.
This is why I love this guy.
Yeah. Get up. No, that's amazing. And let me just ask Greg if you can put Craig and Eric's Twitter handles up again so that people can follow them online and can and interact with them, because this is, I mean, I know so many people who have this scarcity mindset, man, oh man, I wish it was 10 years ago when I could have invested in Bitcoin and so forth. Well, you're seeing the next evolution, right? So in this abundance mindset, every year is giving you more opportunity than the year before, and more and more and more. And this is just the beginning of this, NFT is a very limited term to explain where we're going. We need new terminology here, Eric.
Yeah.
Just massive opportunity.
Yeah. But world. Just to say, as you just did so eloquently, it's only the beginning.
Yeah, and that's why we were calling them actually early on, vAtoms, virtual atoms, or digital objects. We're trying to contain such a massive idea into a phrase that did make sense and allowed for these revolutions and evolutions to occur that you don't see in just a simple image in an NFT. It goes beyond those things. And we do need better nomenclature to describe these things.
Yeah. We have time for just hopefully a couple more questions. Nia.
On that note, could you explain NFTs and their potential as if to a 10-year-old?
Sure. Let me make it very plain and clear. The human brain equates scarcity with value. There is a reason why, since time immemorial, people collect coins, or they collect stamps, or they collect bottle caps. A bottle cap doesn't have inherent value. And if you could print 1,000 of each bottle cap, it would have zero value. But because this has scarcity, or this stamp has a little flaw, or this coin was used or went through some story associated with it that one can verify and validate, they retain value. People want to collect things. People want to have things that are scarce, and they'll trade for that. That's essentially how we were able to move value in the first place in the physical world. Now, when you go to the digital world, the reason why people don't trade MP3s or apps or website URLs is because they're prevalent. There isn't a one of one. I can take a picture of the Mona Lisa, but it's just a picture. And anyone can make 1,000 copies. To make it super simple, if you take that world, and we're talking about the psychology of scarcity and how that imbues value into items, and you can now go to an independent trust source, right? People were buying and selling virtual goods within games for decades. There's a massive business in doing that, but there's a ceiling on that economy because, one, you know it might be duped, and two, you know if the game dies, the goods die. When you get rid of the game and you gamify the world and take an object and have an independent trust authority to say, this is one of one, and I can trace it, and I can make it so it's authentic, then all the qualities that the brain assigns to a physical object and gives it value can now be assigned to something made out of imagination that is actually a digital object. This is why we call it a virtual atom. And an NFT really is that. It's something that's made out of bits that can't be copied or duplicated or double spent. And therefore it has value as a unique one-of-one thing in the world. And the brain will assign value to that.
I'm going to make an NFT out of that explanation.
And I will buy it.
Nice. Okay, Nia, let's squeeze in one more.
Question from Tim. Could NFTs possibly replace trademarking and or patenting?
Wow.
I wouldn't say replace. I'm going to let Craig take this, but I'm going to say one thing about patents. I think it's one of the all-time great use cases for NFTs. The problem with patents, I find, is they're very difficult to move around. You got your patent trolls that buy them up and they sue the heck out of people. They fight over things, but you can make it very, very simple by taking a patent and putting it on the blockchain and making it tradable and giving it a value. I mean, imagine the dormant value that would be unlocked if $1 trillion worth of patents are suddenly become liquid money, where people whose intellectual property maybe they're sitting in poverty, but their grandfather left them this patent. They have no idea what to do with. They don't have the resources to find it. Imagine if that was actually liquid. Putting patents in an NFT and making them liquid is absolutely astounding. It's an amazing idea.
Yeah, I would agree with Eric. It's not going to replace the idea of patents and trademarks, but if you think about what a blockchain does, is it's actually timestamping a piece of information. So as Eric mentioned, it's provenance. It allows you to establish prior art. If you want to have that unique idea that you want to trademark or you want to have a patent for a process and you actually have that recorded on a blockchain, that's timestamped forever. And if you were the first one to conceive of that thing, that's now the evidence that you need to show the world, this is my idea or this is my phrase, this is my thing, and they have to recognize it.
And then you can move it on a marketplace. Exactly. And it's amazing. One thing about marketplaces is people will buy things even if they don't want them because they perceive them as undervalued. If there's liquidity, this stuff will move. And that creates a lot of wealth for people who might need it.
Amazing. This is all about the increasing velocity of capital, the velocity of ideas, the velocity of creation. And it's, people who say can't get any faster, hold on. we haven't even hit the warp speed button yet. Listen, I just want to say thank you, Eric, and thank you, Craig. Eric, you are one of my dearest, closest friends on the planet. Craig, thank you for your brilliance, and grateful to my Abundance Digital community. I hope you enjoyed this as much as I do. Please watch the rerun. And this is just extraordinary content for entrepreneurs, because there are going to be hundreds of billion-dollar companies, thousands of billion-dollar companies built on the back of this capability in the decade and decades ahead. Our next webinar is going to be on Wednesday, June the 2nd at 1 p.m. Pacific time. And we are meeting with the CEO of Chef Robotics. So imagine a robot in your kitchen that can cook you, you know, the gourmet meals, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Just download the app, make sure Amazon delivers the right components, and it's cooked to perfection every single time. So it's going to be on Wednesday, June the 2nd, 1 p.m., the CEO of Chef Robotics. Eric and Craig, thank you, my friends.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you very much.
Loved it.